All right, so today is Thursday, May 11th, 2023. My name is Emily Ma, and I'm here with Ms. Naomi Kuo for the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice. So to start from the very beginning, could you tell us where and when you were born?
Hey, I was born in, I believe, St. Joseph Hospital in Houston. My parents were living in Sugar Land at the time. I was born January 19th, 1991.
And how would you describe the household that you grew up in?
I think we moved out just, after I was 2 months old or something. So I don't have a lot of memories of that house. I believe it was my parents' first house that they owned. And it's a one-story, like very quite modest. In this older part of Sugar Land. They had moved there to be closer to my mom's work at the time. She was working for my uncle's like lab or something. Was also in Sugar Land.
And I understand you have a sibling.
Yes.
Did you grow up speaking Mandarin, English, or like a mix of both with your parents?
Yes, I have a sibling, older brother by 2 years. His name is Vincent. I grew up speaking a mix of English and Mandarin with my parents. And then they sort of spoke Taiwanese between themselves as a secret language, so we didn't know. Like my brother and I didn't know Taiwanese. Yeah.
That's funny. How would you also describe like the school district area that you grew up in?
By the time I was two, so we after Sugar Land, my family moved to Corpus Christi. And then I moved back in 1993. I believe to Friendswood, Texas, the Harris County side. So I went to CCISD. I think it was like pretty peaceful overall, like middle class. I remember in high school I went to Clear Brooks and there were like occasional like fights and that kind of thing, but nothing too, scary.
And do you have any like favorite childhood memories you'd like to share, or any like memories of like your first art related memories maybe?
Oh, sure. Let's see. General good childhood memories are just like gatherings at my grandma and aunt's house in Clear Lake. I think we would go there like every week or something, and I feel like a lot of my parents' friends, they had boys, so I had to like learn how to play with the boys, like video games and I don't know, roughhousing and that kind of thing. Art memory, I always loved to draw when I was a kid, and I kept this little like drawing binder that I maybe like assumed would be like kept forever or something, my drawings in there. And I had this best friend named Sarah who lived a couple houses down in a cul-de-sac. And we would, I think one summer or so, I got into like making doll houses or something. We'd just like cut up cardboard boxes and I'd start with like one house and like, Sarah, we're gonna make a doll house. And then I was like, no, we're gonna make a city. She's like, no, we haven't even finished with the house. And we would I think I was into Little House on the Prairie, so I'd like hide under my neighbor's bushes and pretend I was in the, wilderness, and mix like concoctions of people's plants for like booby traps for bad guys, that kind of thing. So it was a good time, just like within a little cul-de-sac, a lot of fun. So
nice. That sounds really sweet. Do you still have the binder or like the dollhouse that you made?
Dollhouse, no. Binder, yes, I believe so.
Nice. It's good to like look back on like your very first drawings.
Yeah.
So about your parents, where were they born and what were their occupations?
They were both and they grew up there. They met in pharmacy school in Taiwan. So in Taiwan, my mom was a pharmacist and my dad was a pharmaceutical salesman for a few years, and then When he moved with his family to Texas, and later my mom joined him, he recertified as a pharmacist and practiced in the US. Yeah. My mom did farm tech here as well, so.
And did they influence like you becoming an artist in any way? Like, did they ever have like drawing as a hobby?
I would say no, although I think they supported it, a little at least. I remember doing like an actual like drawing class outside of school when I was pretty young. And sometimes my elementary school did sort of after school like art programs that like my mom would drive me to. I remember getting like the full like RoseArt set of like 50 colors. It's always very exciting. But no, they're quite musical. But as far as like visual arts, they themselves don't. I think they didn't have the environment necessarily to like develop that. But even so, I think they would have preferred music in particular. So yeah, it's just something that is mostly from me. Although my grandmothers were quite like crafty, say, or like, yeah, I think it's just a different culture as well.
And within your family, did you celebrate any like traditional Taiwanese holidays or like cultural traditions growing up?
Not too many or to a significant degree, I'd say. Yeah, I feel like somehow we lost both like traditional Taiwanese celebrations and we were like very lukewarm about American traditions. It was like nothing. But I think there were some like Chinese New Year stuff that we do. Like in elementary school, I remember making some like collage picture book for my school, and I think they like kept it and laminated it like about like how to celebrate Chinese New Year. So I think there is something enough that I would have some kind of memory, but yeah, I think as my, when like grandparents passed away and that kind of thing, I feel like that faded as well. There's less of a reason to celebrate, yeah.
Yeah, I know you mentioned your both of your grandmothers were like crafty. Did they have like a art style that they like to do, or is it more like DIY?
My paternal grandmother, she like knitted clothes and crocheted and stuff like that. And she was very frugal. I think like she and my aunt got really into like garage sales when they moved to the US. It was like gathering stuff. I think like I inherited like trash bags, giant trash bags full of like yarn that is like wavy. So you can tell it was like unraveled from a sweater or something. And they would, I guess she had planned to keep that to make stuff out of. But in the early days for her, she did that as like a household, like business, like a cottage business. And then my maternal grandmother, actually don't know too much about her, but I know she actually worked in like garment factories for a living. So she supported the family that way in Taiwan.
That's really cool. And I know we might talk about your quilts later in the interview. But yeah, that's for later. So moving on to like education slash work. So you attended UT Austin for undergrad, and there you studied both English and studio art. So why did you choose to double major in these fields?
I think early on in high school, since both of my parents were in the healthcare field, and I feel like a lot of my peers, like in the Asian American community, went that way. I was like, I could be a doctor. I could do it. Like, I think I'm kind of smart or something. And then later, I was like, no, like. I think I took to heart kind of the Christian teaching of just putting to use your like talents, your God-given talents to, you know, serve your community, make to develop that as sort of like that's your responsibility. So I was like, I chose instead of like doing something that I thought would be a cool accomplishment, instead of doing that, to kind of follow where I thought I was uniquely gifted, and that would have been the arts. And I was interested in literature at the time. My favorite classes were always English. Read a lot. And so yeah, I chose that. I started my undergraduate years as an English major first, and then like after waffling a bit, I was like, oh, I can't leave art behind, and I added that on. Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, that's how I chose it.
Nice. And did you see any like similarities between those two fields while you were in college?
I think I tried to make connections. Sometimes it is a bit difficult to, you have these like interdisciplinary aspirations in college, but it's hard to realize them because, you know, every department does their own thing at times. Similarities, I mean, I ended up not going down the creative writing route with English. I think like I used to write poetry when I was a kid. I wasn't never like a storyteller. Like I didn't write stories really. So I don't know. I think if I had gone down that field, there would have been more similarities. Like if you're like generating new art in both fields. But I was kind of curious to see, like, as I was studying different like writers, like which kind of poets were like more interested in the idea of like what art is, and they would like write about like art in general or visual arts even. And so I wrote like a really cringy thesis on that that I have not opened. I like worked really hard to write a thesis in the English honors program, and then I've not cracked open that book since then. But it's good to learn how to research, I will say that. Very valuable. But yeah, I think the English department was like dusty hallways, you know. I feel like when I was in school, it was the emphasis on like reading diverse authors was like not that big of a deal. And so it was like, you know, the Europeans and old white guys kind of thing, which I still loved, I guess. Yeah, whereas I think in visual arts, I saw more of a possibility to explore ideas organically and like to use multiple mediums to do so. And I could see myself going down that route more. So I ended up, yeah, not advancing in English, but continuing with art.
And like in your art studio, did you have any like professors that left a lasting impact on your life?
I would say in my undergraduate years, I was still very much like exploring. And I think like, I feel like I wasn't like a diehard studio art student at the time. Like, you could point out, you'd be like, you look like an art student. I didn't feel like I looked like an art student. Like I didn't put in those kind of intense hours. Maybe because I was also doing like work in the English department, and yeah, but so I feel like I was a very kind of just touch and go kind of student. But I think like getting to interact with some of the graduate students who were there, who were TAs, like that kind of helped planted the seed of like, oh, you can go further like with your art education. And I did go to Italy one summer in UT's like study abroad, like arts program, art and art history. And so I think I really appreciated like the two professors that went with us there. I didn't really keep in touch after I moved away, but I feel like that door is still open. Like, I still have some like sleuthing, track down some people and reconnect. So, yeah, positive overall, and just like good to be exposed to, and to see that some, you know, some professors are kind of like snooty and nasty, and the others are really friendly, and there's kind of a mix of people.
Do you have any memories of when you studied abroad in Italy?
Oh yeah, certainly. Memories, particular memories you're asking for. I don't know. I think just getting to really deep dive into, like, it's not like it was a different experience than if I had just gone with family or friends, for sure. Because it's like we got to hit up like every major cathedral and like look at the tiles, look at the fresco, you know, like this is this and that apostle story, or like wow, you're in the presence of, you know, Caravaggio or something like that. I think getting to experience like Italian cooking, like I think just some local ladies. Oh, we lived in this former nunnery, I don't know, like a convent. And like, you know, windows without bug screens, no AC, like you can only use one electrical appliance at once. Like living that kind of lifestyle in a smallish like mountain town was interesting. Yeah, but I do recall after going to Italy was like my way of like investing in a future in the arts, because I feel like that was the crossroads of like you could find a pharmacy, you could get certified as a pharmacy technician and like have a fallback option, or you know, you could put in more experience or like seek more experience with art and go further that way. But I do remember coming back home that summer, I was like, there was no aha moment of like, that was life changing. I definitely am meant to be an artist. Like, I think there's always very much the conflict of like, was that worth it? Am I good at it? Like, did I have fun? Like, I don't know. It's a mixed bag sometimes, but yeah. But still good. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, it sounds like it was like a turning point for you, but maybe you realized it a bit later on rather than like at that moment. So after graduating college in 2013, you then traveled to New York. So you then worked at Transform Arts and at Thrive Collective. So before we dive into both of these experiences, could you first tell us what it was like to live in New York, especially since you'd been in Texas ever since you were born until you graduated college?
What it was like. So I was there for over 8 years. And I feel like my experiences came in like 2 year, 4 year chunks. So every kind of phase felt different. But in general, I mean, I think I moved at a good time in the sense that like I was just open-minded, like naive enough, trusting enough, right? Like to go, and I had the support of like working with this like faith-based organization that you do like raise your support to be able to go. And so it wasn't like stressful in the financial sense in the way that it typically is, right? Like of kind of having to hustle. So I'm very grateful for that. But yeah, I think I just appreciated like the different environment, like that kind of dense big city feel. And I appreciated that like you can see people from, you sound so cliche, from all walks of life, but also like different social classes kind of having to rub shoulders. Like growing up in the suburbs, like in the middle class kind of world. I feel like you can jump in your car, you know, go to where you want to go and don't have to really pay attention to what you don't want to see, or you just kind of avoid, you never go places where you don't want to see. Whereas you have to pass it in New York City. Or everyone's riding the subway or something, or you have to walk. And I feel like that's a more honest view of like where you live. And I think I wanted to grow in that kind of like compassionate seeing, I guess. And plus it's just very like visually interesting. And I feel like people, there's it has a history of just like people wanting to make a difference in their communities or like facing challenges, but like pushing forward both in like the sort of like faith slash missions field and also in art and like activism. So I was like, this is where I want to like learn from others or like from people who've been here before, even if it's like not in the, you know, immediate, like if it was something in the recent past or anything too, right? Like, yeah. It's very different. Like, you know, you can't just like load up your grocery cart with like everything you need for a month or something, right? Because like I didn't have a car either. You have to kind of, it's a different rhythm of life, right? Like you have to learn how to be like very self-contained with like your belongings and what you carry with you from place to place. Yeah.
So within this transition in lifestyle, did you find that working at Transform Arts with like the faith-based mission helped you feel more belonging in New York?
Yeah, I'd say so. I was lucky to join the organization with like a friend from college and two other friends who were in the same organization, but we had gone to the college together as well, just kind of like adjusting together. I think that was a blessing. I'd say it's, I think in Texas, in my experience, like kind of moving in mostly Asian American and Asian American Christian circles, like not a lot of people were choosing to pursue art, even though there were a lot of really talented people. You know, there's a handful that went into like radio and film, which is like a degree offered in at UT. But I felt it was good to like get more exposure and opportunities in art, but like within the context of like something I was familiar with, which is like kind of a more like faith-based setting. I think at the same time, I would learn like the need to broaden the circle even further, right? Like it was a good kind of like, way to adjust and to step into a partial unknown with like some support. I would soon kind of realize that, there are a lot of like race-based differences or just like to encounter like political differences, like that people don't always talk about within like Christian circles. And sometimes that causes some friction, but yeah, I think, I guess it's a process. Yeah, but grateful as well.
Earlier you mentioned like the different infrastructure of New York and then also its rich history. Could you talk a bit more about your project Building Stories that you did with Fina Yeung?
Sure. That was my first little like two-person show in this space. The neighborhood church in Greenwich Village, they basically have their main kind of like meeting space as a gallery as well. And through the sort of like Christian artist network, I had started out like co-leading this like breakfast meetup group where we just like read articles and share our art together. And you know, very early in the morning, like before other people had to work, go to some coffee shop. Anyway, so I knew this guy from there, and he kind of facilitated things at the gallery. And I had met Fina because I'm just doing my best as this like 22-year-old, right? Like to network in a new city. I went to a Asian American Arts Alliance A4 meeting. I was like, Naomi, you're gonna meet one person, just like, and so they do these short presentations, like you can sign up to like share about your art. So Fina had shared about her art and I was just attending. I was like, you know, my name's Naomi, or like something very like trying to meet someone. And we ended up chatting, and she came to one of the breakfast meetups, and like there's some resonances between like her work and mine. And so we just did a show together. It's awesome. Yeah, I think it was at the tail end of my time as a, at the sort of like intern level with Transform Arts, the like artist in residence program. So it was good to show a lot of the work that I had done in my studio time through that program. Yeah, I think the artwork itself in there for me, it's just, I think, my way of like taking in the city and like being sensitive to my surroundings. And I think being curious of like, what do the materials themselves tell us about like this moment of flux or change? And they're usually, I don't know, most people would be like, where are all the people? Like, New York's never empty. So maybe there's some sense of like just trying to find like my own place within the city still, kind of exploring that curious but lonely sort of feeling. And I would say that's like some of my best drawing. Like, I kind of strayed from like drawing and painting as like my main medium since then. So I kind of look back and like, dang, wonder if I can still do that. Grateful for that show. And I'm still friends with Fina. Hope to kind of reconnect with her when I visit. But
Do you have like a favorite building that you drew? Or do you not remember like the specific buildings?
I don't know that there's a particular one. I mean, I think the first kind of drawing in that sort of building focused series was like these two sort of row house looking like older single family homes. And I just kind of like blocked out everything surrounding it because they were all like larger apartment buildings. And so there are these sort of like relics of a different time kind of floating in an abstract space. That one I quite liked. But yeah, I believe I sold that one, so I don't have it around anymore. But yeah.
So next, you worked as a muralist and a teaching artist at Thrive Collective, and that is an organization that centers around mentoring students at public schools. So could you explain a bit more about Thrive Collective and then also your work within the organization?
Yeah, I like to say that I got to do a lot of things that I wasn't qualified for in that time period in New York. Or it, all that to say, like a lot of opportunities came up because I worked with Thrive while I worked with Transform, and so it was a bit of a partnership. Even though Thrive wasn't a faith-based, but explicitly faith-based, like its organizer was really connected in the circles. And I, at first, I was able to work there on like a volunteer basis because part of like my role with Transform was I had hours to give to like community service center, like related things. That was like a good turning point of like looking at walls to painting on walls, in a sense, or kind of like wondering about how communities form and maintain their well-being through time, to like through Thrive, like going to public schools that lacked, or were in a moment where like a lot of their art funding was cut, and so they didn't have like an art teacher or like a really robust art education. Or at times there was like one art teacher and I would kind of partner with him. And it took me to out of like circles where I was living in Astoria, which is like Western Queens. It's like very close to Manhattan, and a lot of other people who also moved to New York recently would like, you know, live there first or something, right? So a lot of people that I was getting to know locally were also recent transplants like myself. But working with Thrive, I would go to like, I worked primarily in the Bronx. Just getting to see like predominantly like Puerto Rican community or like just like Black and Brown communities, right? Like was I think a good step for me out of that like comfortable or just like the version of New York that I would naturally have seen to ones that have been around for longer and have kind of their own set of cultures, as well as like needs and strengths and stuff. But I think the nature of like filling in for the lack of like larger art funding and like resources for these communities like is kind of, it's just inherently chaotic a bit. And it was like the sort of earlier years for the organization as well, so I think it was still kind of finding best practices and rhythms and stuff. So it was like a lot of, it's hard work. I think like one, just kind of being a drop-in teacher and like having to learn classroom management stuff for some schools where that's like a little bit of a struggle, or just kind of learning what's like bite-sized enough, like appropriate art education to where like people have the tools to like reflect on a theme together. So all of the murals are collaborative in the sense that like we may come in with like a loose theme and they would kind of respond and give input, and we'd put all those drawings together and then like submit designs for their further input. So it was like this process that was really cool. It also helped me to revive like my Photoshop skills and bring that into like my own art practice. It was kind of laying dormant there. Now I'm like mostly on the computer, like for scenes and like kind of drawing by hand, but also scanning in and like getting to manipulate things digitally. I think being up on like two or three level like scaffolding structures, like painting a giant handball like court in the middle of the summer. Nice like bonding experiences with like people that I worked with. Also led me to see like I was curious about like how much more effective I could be if like, for one, I could stay in a community for longer. Like these were like, you know, a couple weeks at the end of their semester after they finished testing, and you may or may not return like based on what they wanted or what the funding was like. Plus I didn't live there, right? Like, so what would it be like to be in a neighborhood that like you actually lived, or like you identify more with the community? And then I'm like, surely there's more to like community-based art than like murals. And so I think that set me on the track to go to grad school for socially engaged art, and to also move to Flushing, Queens after that, where it's like a primarily Asian community.
Nice. Do you have any like particular memories from working with the students that stand out to you?
Uh, I think just bits and pieces. Like, I would bring my sketchbook over just to, like sometimes show people how to draw certain things that they didn't know how to draw. And, I remember some students would be really excited about the sketchbook and like, or kind of trick me into like drawing it for them or something. Yeah, or they would like practice on my sketchbook. So they have very sweet moments. Yeah, I think painting murals, like you end up going into spaces that you don't usually walk in. And so like the 3 feet of grass behind like a fence and between the fence and the building or something, right? Like where there's like a mouse trap and like some trash. But like I think being in those spaces, like with the students and who are all just like always super excited to paint. Like paint is like catnip for kids, I feel like. It's like, you know, it's so tactile and like it changes and yeah, so I think yeah, just going into those like marginal spaces and having fun there, it's a good memory.
I like the catnip analogy.
No.
Is the mural like the largest thing you've ever painted, or do you have like any other large scale projects?
Yeah, I would say that's the largest. The others are not quite like building wall sized, like a large quilt maybe, or like a temporary structure, but
So fast forwarding a bit to 2021. So that's when you moved from NYC back to Houston. Can you think of some art related things that you could find in one city but not the other?
I'm still exploring what is in Houston, so I can't say definitively something is not here at this point. But I feel like in New York, there's more like artist collectives or artist run like nonprofits even that are maybe more environmentally focused or like works on water. I don't know, even laundromat project, not exactly environmentally focused, but like kind of social practice or like art that involves like community or like interventionist kind of actions or bringing art to like everyday spaces and like, you know, local communities. I'm hopeful that I'll find more in Houston and or maybe, you know, if I yeah, if I kind of find my own niche and working and can maybe start something here as well. But yeah. I think like I really enjoyed that sort of movement towards like a hyper local focus with artists where, you know, they want to just as part of their own communities, like bring attention to certain things or you know, highlight undertold stories or kind of activate different spaces. Yeah, I'm curious, and I think, and I found those things like living kind of like towards the edge of Queens, like we're getting into Long Island almost, right? Like whereas I know of more art stuff happening in like with the, like in downtown Houston or like within 610. I don't know if all of that is called downtown, but sometimes within Beltway 8, but living Like I moved with my parents to like edge of Missouri City, like to the east a little. And so I feel like I don't know if people are doing like the same level of like culture making in the outskirts of Houston, or like yeah, or maybe it's more of like a multi-generational kind of like gathering of hobbyists kind of like groups that are like that I've seen in Sugar Land, which is like cool and needed as well. But yeah, I'd love to see more like work on like environment down here, or like collective work. I'm starting to meet, really interesting individual artists.
So speaking of like environmental works, or I guess kind of hyperlocal as well, one of your projects, Garden Connections, won you grant funding from the Idea Fund Houston this year. Could you explain a bit more about your project and kind of the process behind it?
Yeah, sure. So let's see. I'd started to do projects where I wanted to create a sort of open platform for people to share their stories on different themes, right? Like I would one of them took the form of like quilting workshops where like people from the community like kind of taught each other, and then the next was like walks within Flushing amongst different Asian Americans to sort of like grasp at like what makes living here, like how does that form an like a certain identity or way of relating to space. But and so like I feel like the next step sort of logically for me was especially after moving back to Houston, was like now just kind of like revisiting spaces and like family connections that I had like a longer term like history with, right? Because like I had only lived in Flushing for like 4 years, or at the time when I was doing projects, like even less time. So I was like trying to bring up stories that I did not personally live through, right? Or like was not around for. And I feel like there I'm still like you're never really fully native or belonging somewhere. I feel like everyone moves around, whether or not it's like location or maybe you're busy with different things. But anyways, like it's not so much about like finding belonging, I think, necessarily for me in this project, but I think that sense of like wanting to like celebrate people who have like helped, like been in touch with my family for like decades. So I'm like interviewing like different people who have like given my family like gardening help in the last year, something that like my parents and I have like restarted in our home. And like I think in the process of like tracing those like exchanges, like celebrating like those friendships, and like the backyard garden is like a very like Asian space for me. Like it's very like visually, some things are quite like particular. Like I did a lot of artwork about those spaces in Flushing, like when I lived there. That was like one of those like, oh, I am very familiar with like that particular aesthetic, and I would like notice that and draw that and kind of reflect on that. And so now I have like personal access to these spaces because I know the gardener owner now. And yeah, so I think it's about like celebrating like those aesthetics and like the pragmatism and just the sort of like yeah, long-term practice that people have of growing things that is a little more prevalent in like the older generation. And No, I think it may expand to like doing interviews of other gardeners beyond like strictly, oh, you've like interacted with my family kind of organically before. So it might end up like revealing more of like a larger network. But still, I mean, it's like tracing how an average person, myself, like is connected. Like when once you start meeting people and you're like, oh yeah, actually you're only like 2, 3 degrees separated from, you know, this amazing auntie gardener in like Katy or something, right? Like, yeah, so I'm hoping it'll like take me to different like places around Houston that like I wouldn't have normally gone. So it's similar, I guess, to my first impulse that like I talked about with like moving to New York. Like, yeah, like making your way through the city in a way that like breaks your usual like patterns of behavior to like discover some kind of like treasure that's always been there. Yeah, and I think a lot of the gardeners are like getting older as well, and so I think it's like about passing on like what they know as well, and encouraging more people to like connect with nature, and to also share of like their abundance in the way that a lot of people like have shared with us.
Yeah, there's like, it's kind of funny because there's, I guess, a stereotype of artists being these like solitary people who are like always locked in their rooms all day. But clearly there's like, for you at least, like teaching and like forging new relationships and kind of giving back to the community is something that you do with your art. So what would you say art means to you? And like, do you have an artistic mission?
Yeah, you know, I've had to think a lot about these things recently. And I don't know that I have like, you know, art will mean something different in different seasons, I think. But yeah, I think art means like getting to dream and be absurd and kind of be a mad scientist with ideas, and you know, maybe some of them helps the larger society. Like, you know, you're just kind of experimenting. Yeah, because I think like, and this maybe ties into more of like a mission sense, but I think there are like we get used to relating to each other, or like a certain community may know like have a certain body of knowledge that doesn't get spread out to other people because like that's just how the relationships are contained. But I think part of like I don't know, living better together in a diverse society means like facing these truths and histories that are not always like acknowledged by all. Yeah, or like seeing ourselves as like this kind of big living, breathing city that's like reliant on all these hidden infrastructures, right? That have like different impacts on the environment. And I think, yeah, just like helping people see beyond like the cocoon of like a day-to-day like experience, to feel part of something bigger, yeah, and to see that the beauty of those, you know, other like stories and knowledge and skills that you may not have encountered normally. But yeah, I think it's hard, like an artist, art also means being supported by the people around you. I think you kind of you need to have your basic needs met in order to dream, or it's in the process of like finding alternate ways to meet basic needs in community and like forging new possibilities that way in connection with like meeting one's basic needs. So yeah, I think also there's always an element of like connecting with kind of the most fundamental aspect of art, which in a way is like self-expression or just like sensory needs or like experimentation, not necessarily on the like grand idea scale, but just like, ooh, what does like green yarn and purple yarn look like together, right? Like just getting to do that in your own like daily rhythms, I think is important. Yeah, it's like it's hard to imagine a life. I think I would always be like just randomly making things as well, even if I didn't pursue it professionally. But yeah, oh yes, also I think I grew a little weary thinking about like if art, like the goal of being an artist is just to be this like mega international superstar or something like that shows in museums. Like, I don't know if I have that kind of energy. Like, my hustle is wearing thin. But I think, like, if at best, like, if an artist can be this like prototypical, like, everyday person, but you get to like kind of revel in your limitations or just like show those kind of like vulnerable sides that like all of us have, but there's some kind of catharsis in being like, oh, like this person is showing it, is like displaying it, and like we can all normalize our like humanness. Because while I can have like really lofty like missions, like I don't want people to get left behind when there's like a drought or a heat wave, right? Or like, you know, maybe the grandma that doesn't speak English. I think about those kind of people. I think like why we need to build better community these days. But at the same time, like, I don't always make time to like spend time with family, right? Like, I think there's like, acknowledging our own limitations, like I said, are just like we don't all live out our ideals the way that we want to, but we can kind of like strive for that together and kind of like learn from each other as we're doing that. Yeah.
Yeah. So, kind of related to that spirit of like collaboration or like kind of giving back to others, one of your pieces that I really love is Social Practice. Could you kind of describe, or sorry, one of your projects, Eco Craft for Friends, like under your social practice project, could you describe how it helped you kind of get through the pandemic?
That started the pandemic. I was living in New York. I had only recently started my first job after grad school, which was working at a multidisciplinary art center in a neighborhood in Queens. Being like the only visual arts staff at the time, just kind of like trying to hold things together, and then like, you know, reinventing a whole online world for programs when, you know, lockdown happened. It was really stressful. Thinking a lot about like the importance of community, especially where I think I was raised to prioritize just like working hard or like, even pursuing different achievements just by like kind of burying yourself in work, you kind of find it, you emerge and you're like, ooh, to survive, I need friends. And, you know, I'd been thinking about that for a while. And it's just kind of confirmed through the pandemic when, you have to, especially in the absence of having family around you, you really have to rely on your community and your friends. For that project, I had just started this online residency, artist residency with City Seminary of New York, who I'd interned with in my early days in New York. And so it came time to propose a project. And at first I had this really kind of ambitious project in mind. I had just sort of like found out that like my parents had very different political views than me in that really contentious like election time. It was during the what do you call it? January 6th, when people
the insurrection.
Insurrection, that's the word. I think just I wanted to do something about like the different media worlds we live in, and the sort of like networks of knowledge that I was talking about, like, and find a way to like, I don't know, share in an intergenerational way, like what we care about, and hopefully in a way that was like more inviting than like kind of divisive as it felt at the time. But I was like, I don't have the energy for that. Like, let's be honest. It was a very, like, let's be honest, like, time in, of life, right? Like, we're all kind of coming to, it was right before the I don't dream of labor kind of, like, trend, right? Like, we're all kind of questioning work at the same time. But, so I guess in an effort to, like, be honest about, like, kind of my mental health needs, I guess, or like just like being honest about capacity and sort of like questioning that just like bury your head in work like kind of mode, I was like, let me just like make crafts. And like I had already done a lot of projects using like kind of consumer waste, I guess, like, you know, different like wrappers, especially like stuff from like the Chinese grocery stores, like kind of tying in like those, the aesthetics of those like products into my like collage kind of tapestry work. So I was working with a lot of trash, but for different reasons at the time. I think I'd always been like frugal as well, and like the quilting impulse is really to like save all your old fabric things too, so it, you know, that was already part of me. I was getting really interested in like composting and just like being more aware of like environmental issues at the same time, and so I think just in the spirit of the mad artist like scientist, I was like, these seems almost related, right? Like the need to like maintain your relationships and like tend to your own sort of like, I don't know, well-being and community in the way that like tending to things that you don't really think about when you're busy or you're like in the middle of something big, and you only realize during a crisis that like, wow, I needed to actually maintain that or like take care of that a lot more. I think the same can be said of our environment as well. Like, we don't think of a lot of things just in the way that things are built and optimized for us until things go wrong, right? And I think it helped me get out of like more of a sense of helplessness, because you're almost like forcing gifts on people, like, I made this little scrunchie for you to take it, right? But it's a kind of way to like trick yourself into like taking that first step to like reach out to someone, or in the process you do get to check on others too, so it's not all about your needs necessarily either, right? Yeah. But it was fun, I think, like that kind of performance as project. I'm not really a performance artist, but it was a relief to like do something at that scale and, you know, not overly document it necessarily either. Yeah.
Nice. I'm glad that art was a way for you and your loved ones to stay a little more sane during the
Yeah,
pandemic.
sure.
Yeah, so as you said, art, like at its most fundamental, is kind of about experimentation and just being curious. So you have created a wide range of art pieces, including mixed media quilts, paintings, drawings, and zines. So do you have like a main medium, or are they all kind of equal in your mind?
It's really anyone's guess at this point. Like, I think probably sewing will always be one of them. I'm almost doing zines as a default medium at this point, so I'm not sure, like, you know, if I'll explore some aspect of what a zine does, but in a different way. But yeah, I think I do enjoy the sort of like art form where you're not necessarily like belaboring the process or like really beating yourself up to like get an image that in a perfect way, in the way that like sometimes paintings and drawings end up being for me. In the sort of like potential for mass distribution is interesting. That sort of way of thinking about art as like primarily communication versus like a unique object, right? And probably like my kind of literary side reemerging. Yeah, and the like sequential nature of a zine is interesting to me. Like you get to lead people on a journey. But yeah, maybe it's funny. Zines had a heyday apparently, you know, early 2000s or something like that, when people wanted to go back to being analog. I think they're still around. I think it's still around. It's fine. Yeah. So okay, so I do like zines right now. I like the sort of use of recycled materials or like cast-offs and yeah, like letting that be the substrate of your work or like being kind of like waste conscious at all levels of your art. I think that's interesting to me. So I think that's why I'm drawn more to like quilting and sewing and collaging more so than just like painting on a canvas. So quilts and zines.
Yeah, I can definitely see how like environmentalism and kind of recycling is present in a lot of your art. Speaking of quilting, did you like learn to sew for the purpose of quilting, or was that a skill you already had?
Well, it's a mix. I'm sure my mom taught me like the basics of like, you know, needle, thread goes through needle, tie a knot. And I think I made my own like kind of falling apart at the seams like doll clothes when I was very little. But I did learn how to the concept of like piecing together quilts. Like, you know, you put the right sides together, you sew a line, and then when you fold it open, the raw sides on the underside, like that little process I learned from a like Malaysian friend, like the daughter of like the pastor at the time at this little like Taiwanese church. Like our parents would get together and she was a little bit older, so she was probably like, I have to entertain this little girl. Like, and her grandmother had made like these like pretty simple quilts. It's just like, you know, a bunch of triangles together. But she showed me the process of that and I was like, this is magic. And like I was like 8 or something. And I think Yeah, like every summer since then, I would like undertake this like full size like quilt. I mean, like baby, like a crib size quilt maybe, but like it took like my whole summer just to like make a quilt. So I did that. So yeah, I got into sewing for the purpose of quilting mostly. Yeah.
Do you ever sew quilts for like warmth purposes, or is it always for like art?
I don't think I necessarily felt the lack of blankets or something, but they are mostly used as like functioning quilts. Yeah, we don't really hang anything on walls in my family home. I have made wall hangings before, but yeah, I think I had read some like theory of craft book at some point in New York. And I think the sort of like the boundaries around making things that are like that re reference the human body and like that have to fill certain functions, like keeping a person warm or like holding a thing. Like, I think that's interesting. Yeah. Whereas, the sort of like this could be anything sort of like approach to art making that, you know, when it's just an object for contemplation is different. Yeah, so I like things that have some other function as well sometimes.
And across your varied like art interests, are there any other artists who you particularly admire or look up to?
There are like no none in particular in the sense of like top of mind as I'm making my own art. And I think about that sometimes as like maybe that needs to change. Like it's good to always like be inspired or like let oneself be inspired by other people or like have a reference. But I think in the course of like my education and sort of like perusal, a few artists came to mind as like kind of touchstones. Let's see. Think like Mary Mattingly in New York is an artist who like at one point I remember Art 21 is a great resource. I saw her work through Art 21 of like she had create like collected all of her like personal waste or something, and it like became this huge like boulder that she like rolled across the bridge or like you know visualizing like those invisible you know processes, things that we are like we threw it away so it went away, but like there's no way, right? Like and to sort of visualize that. And in college, I think the moment where I was like, yeah, I want to be an artist is I think I was at the Visual Arts Center at UT, you know, art department. And they were showing some kind of like Patty Chang video. So she's like an American, Chinese American artist. But yeah, she sort of gets to like play with like history and geography and like does performances with her parents. Like, I think like bringing in like different aspects of like who she is and like even her family life and like very fantastical as well. Like, you know, one of her later projects is she's like tracking down like a lost lake through like the deserts of like Western China, right? Or something like that. Yeah, I thought that was really cool. And I like artists who bring in like their kind of other roles in life, right? Like being a mother or being a daughter, or kind of like bringing to light like you know environmental justice issues, like by like kind of photographing your like everyday environment or like what it's like to live in those kind of places, or yeah. I think in New York, like groups like the Chinatown Art Brigade, where They're really just like being in service of like other sort of like activist groups, and using different like art or like street tactics to bring awareness to like gentrification, or I think all those different modes are interesting. I guess Miri, I can never say her name. Muriel Ukeles is a touch is a great example as well, right? Like the sort of what is her term? I don't remember, but like service as art, or like bringing attention to the ways that like we labor to keep life going. Like, for example, the work maintenance art. There you go. Like, yeah, I think that's a good inspiration. Yeah, I won't name drop any further.
I'm sure there are other artists who also look at your work and feel the same way.
I hope so.
So moving on to our last kind of segment, on identity. So could you tell us how you identify ethnically? For example, do you identify as Taiwanese or Taiwanese American or something different?
I identify as Taiwanese American. I saw that question. I was like, that's an interesting question. I guess others may choose to answer in different ways, but yeah, because my mom's family, like her father came over after the Chinese Civil War, so like he's a mainlander. And my dad's family like is part like native Taiwanese as well as like the kind of older Chinese gen in Taiwan kind of population. So it's like ethnically, what does that necessarily mean? It's like politically, citizenship-wise, they were Taiwanese. Yeah. But now we live in America, so it's a mix, yeah.
And do you have any plans to visit Taiwan anytime soon?
Not anytime soon. Although I'd like to. The last time I went, I was 14. And now I'm 32. I would like to actually go with my parents. I think that would be interesting, but health-wise, that may or may not be possible. So I don't know.
And how often do you visit your family, like in Houston, if they still live in Houston?
Yeah, so I currently live with my parents, and my brother lives in Brownsville, Texas. He comes up every few months for like a weekend. And then I have two aunts and one uncle, all on my dad's side in Houston. I see some of them every few months as well. My dad sees them more often. There, two of them live in Clear Lake, so it's closer to where we used to live in Friendswood, but it's a little bit far. But as I do the like garden interviews, actually, I'm like have an excuse to, to see them. But yeah, it's I think it's been a little more than a year since I've moved back, but I think not living in Houston for a while, and certainly like through the years of the pandemic, it was harder to keep in touch, but yeah, it's an opportunity now, I think, to especially like, you know, the cousins and stuff that are closer to my age. I'd like to keep up with them more. Yeah. As of now, it's here and there.
Yeah, it's great that y'all are all in Texas, so it's a bit easier to keep in touch compared to if you were in another state.
Yeah, I do have other relatives in other states, but yeah, there's a handful in Houston.
Could I also ask about your current hobbies and interests outside of art?
Hmm. Well, gardening's a big one right now. I'm in my second year of gardening. So it's the drama of like, what's this new plant that didn't come up before? Or like, why can't I replicate last year's kind of a fluke success? So that's been great. I think just like, oh, well, I recently just completed the Texas Master Naturalist like initial training. It's basically you get to be a slightly more informed volunteer for the Parks Department. It's a program between the Texas Parks Department and the Texas A&M AgriLife Extension. So you learn all about like local ecology and plants and birds and bugs and water, weather, all that kind of stuff, like very regionally. So that's been cool. So I now need to get in like more volunteer hours at different like conservationists, like prairie conservation stuff, or like, you know, educating the public on like these are the butterflies that are here, or like this is what an animal bone looks like, something like that. So yeah, more I'm more likely to just stop and be like, what is the name of this weed? Or like, it's really fun for me to do that. Yeah. Getting to know native plants and animals and birds and stuff. That keeps me pretty busy, honestly, like those three things. Yeah. And that would be the main things.
Nice. So is that like tour guiding with the public or is it?
There's a lot of different ways that you can sort of fulfill your volunteer hours. At certain parks that are like primarily managed by the Texas Master Naturalists, you can, I think once you gain a certain level of like expertise in a like body of knowledge, like there's like the plant expert or like the bird expert, you can lead interpretive walks, I guess, with the public. I don't see myself doing that necessarily anytime soon, but it's also like you could be the one actually like planting new like native plants, or you know, helping to maintain a tree, or like pulling up invasive things, and like at the Natural History Museum or different like park events, sometimes you know, TMN will have a table and pull out like a little suitcase of like you know, different kind of like sets of like objects that are like teaching opportunities for whoever walks by. Yeah. Sometimes tour guide, sometimes not.
Awesome. That sounds really fulfilling as someone who loves nature.
Yeah, I hope so. Well, I wanted to have a little bit more knowledge to integrate and to offer people as I like develop future projects. So.
And my last question for today is, if you could go back in time and give a piece of advice to your younger self, what would you say?
I would say I don't know, like a combination of like figure out what you love to do, I guess, and not don't worry too much about like looking good to other people. Yeah, or worrying too much about like being accepted even, or like accomplishment. But yeah, I think at the same time, living with an open heart is hard, but more real, I guess. Yeah. Kind of general, but you know, I think it can apply to a lot of things. I think as artists, it's easy to seek accomplishment, or even a student, right? Like, as a sort of protective measure, to gain approval, or to have a sense of like you're worth something if you do something really well. But I think trying to move through life vulnerably, but like sort of building strength through your relationships and sort of like grounding spiritually, I think is a more solid way forward.
I think that's really good advice. So that's all all the questions I have prepared today, but do you have anything else that you want to add?
I don't know. I guess like whoever is comes across this interview or is doing research on Asian American, you know, experiences in Houston. Good luck. I think like I'm finding more and more that like there's just so much diversity in experience. You know, even those who've stayed in Houston the whole time, you know, people's lives diverge and ways of thinking diverge. And then if you're bringing in, you know, experiences from elsewhere, there's no one way of being Asian American in Houston. And I certainly hope also that, you know, we all come to have a better like way of relating with Asia as well. And I think when I grew up, it was like, I think I called one of my friends a fob and like very nonchalant about it. And like she was so offended. I was like, what? That's what you were? Like, right? Like, and the only time I felt proud about being Asian American was once like the sort of like Asian trend came up, where it was like, I don't know, we like pretended to be gangster or something, but like in an Asian way, and it was cool. All of a sudden, instead of being laughed at. But I'm concerned for people who grow up in that kind of environment where like we're just grasping at ways to kind of form our identity. But I'd say learning about our own history and like our own way of like relating to who we are, and fighting like internalized racism, like it's a process. So it's a good thing to remind myself as well. I can be like judgmental of other Asians who like, you know, reveal that they think differently or something. But thanks for interviewing me, I guess, and best of luck with others.
Yeah, thank you so much. And yeah, I definitely agree. I think growing up here can be kind of hard sometimes to feel proud that you're Asian. But yeah, I think it's a work in progress for a lot of people. Yeah, so it was a pleasure talking with you and have a great rest of your day. Thank you so much.
Thanks. You too. Good luck with your studies.
Thank you so
Bye.
much.